What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another edition of the Dolphins In Depth podcast. I'm Daniel Oyefusi, and that is David Neal. Thanks so much for tuning in. Quick reminder before we start, make sure to subscribe to the Miami Herald YouTube page, subscribe to the Miami Herald so you can get your latest Dolphins news and news on everything that's happening in South Florida. Like, comment, all that good stuff. Sunday was a fun night. Sunday was a very fun night if you were a Dolphins fan. If you are a Dolphins fan, a lot of festivities with the celebration and the recognition of the 1972 undefeated perfect team. We had a couple legends from that team service pregame, coin toss captains. A lot of the members of that team were in attendance and recognized at halftime along with some of their family members. And on the field, the Dolphins finally ended their three-game losing streak and Tua's return. It wasn't pretty. No points scored in the second half. But they get the job done, 16-10. Three takeaways kind of cementing that win and leading the charge on that win, including two on the final two Steelers drives. Obviously, Noah Igbinoghene sealing it with that final interception. And the Dolphins moved to 4-3 ahead of their Week 8 road game against the Detroit Lions. We're going to get into all of that, talk about Tua's return, talk about the trade deadline coming up, as well as preview Sunday's game. But of course, we got to start with that game. There's a lot of hype surrounding this game. We talked about it last week, obviously, with the return of Tua, Brian Flores coming back, you know, former head coach coming back now in an assistant role with the Steelers. Obviously, the backdrop of the national, of the Sunday night football national primetime stage. And in the first couple of drives, I mean, the Dolphins looked like they were ready to, you know, get back where they started with Tua before he sustained that concussion. First drive, Tua 6 of 7, throws an 8-yard touchdown pass to Raheem Mostert. A couple drives later, the defense gets a pick. They get a couple field goals. Before you know it, it's 13-0. And hey, I think a lot of people at Hard Rock, a lot of people that were watching the game, I know I was thinking it, this is about to be a rout. The Dolphins are about to say, hey, we're back. Everything is all good in South Florida. But the Steelers came back. They made it a game. And obviously, in the end, the Dolphins were able to hold off. I first got to ask you, what were your thoughts on that performance, and specifically Tua's performance? Because I think that the thought process around this team for a lot of people and a lot of fans was, hey, we lost these three games when Tua was out of the lineup. Tua being back in the lineup, our offense should, you know, start clicking. We should get right back to where we were before that Week 4 injury. And again, the first couple of drives, I mean, it looked like they were that unit that we saw before the injury. Obviously, there was a little bit of rust, a little bit of missed connections that could have turned into big games that Tua talked about. Mike McDaniel said that the Steelers made some adjustments and they didn't. But after that performance, do you leave yourself, you know, more encouraged about the Dolphins with Tua back in the lineup, less encouraged, or are you kind of about the same with them?
No, I think it was a very clear difference of, you know, watching the Dolphins just go quickly, 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 quickly down the field with Tua, who's it was obvious that this is a guy, this is the return of a guy who they've practiced with for a long time, relatively long time, you know, training camp. This was the starting quarterback. And I also think, look, we talked about it before. Sunday night, you know, now it's the big Sunday night's the big night. And, you know, I remember, you know, back when Monday night was the thing, you got some of those games where Monday night football hadn't been there in a while or hadn't been there at all. And they came in, and the crowd was hyped, and everybody was hyped. And the visiting team walked in, and the visiting team walked in, and it was like, boom. And it was, you know, like Rocky in the first Clubber Lang fight, and it was like 17-0 before anybody knew what was happening. And that it felt a little bit like that. That
the crowd was into it, man. Like right. they were juiced for that game. They were right. Ready, especially after that.
They first were ready. Time. The Dolphins were ready, and the players feel that. Players feel that. And here, you know, the Dolphins the Dolphins were charged up. This was a big night, and I think that's what was going on those first few drives. I mean, but he was crisp as heck. I mean, boy, I mean, he was crisper than bacon, man. And Then it was like they either ran out of steam or they just or the fact that they couldn't, you know, those two drives that ended in field goals, it was almost like that's where the, you know, the Hot Wheels started to slow down after coming off the ramp. And then here come the Steelers, and they kind of hung around, and then they made it a game, and suddenly it was like the atmosphere was like, oh yeah, wait a minute, this is an NFL game, this is an NFL team, you are not going to little boy, you know, you're not going to little boy us like that. But I thought Tua played well enough for the Dolphins to win. This was a game the defense won.
As we've seen, has been kind of the theme sometimes. Obviously, the Baltimore game was different, but
right.
Their other two wins, three wins but now, the defense has led the way. The
defense won it. I mean, you can't – you score 16 points. It should have been 19. You should have taken that field goal at the end of the game to make it a two-score game.
They wouldn't have even been in that situation where everyone's on
– Exactly. You're going to sit there. Yeah. This is one of those, analytics. I'm like, the simple math?
But the interesting thing about it, and I did ask McDaniel about that, because I think that a quick aside about that decision, I think a lot of times in this analytically driven football world that we're living in now, a lot of people think that you're just looking at a score sheet or a score, like a laminated sheet, or somebody's in your ear saying, the analytics say go for it. I was very surprised to hear that McDaniel said the numbers didn't, and some people on Twitter showed it. The numbers said that they should have kicked it, and his analytics people said to kick it. So this was actually like a gut feeling that he wanted to put the ball in the end zone, and obviously it backfired. The play call, I wasn't a fan of giving it to Edmonds in that situation, but I thought that was interesting that he kind of eschewed the analytics and said, no, I'm actually gonna. He did the old guard.
Right.
He made the old guard decision. You go with your gut.
But the old guard decision is in line with the analytics decision. Sometimes that happens.
Okay, yeah, true. Okay, that's fair.
I stand corrected on that. But that was to me that was the obvious. He's dude, make it a two score game. This is not hard. This team's only scored 10 points on you. Make them score 10. In 55 minutes of football. Make them score 10 points in what's left. But that's it. You're not going to win a lot of games scoring only 16 points against a defense that's not, this is not the steel curtain of any decade, as we discussed last week. So, it did enough. He did enough to for the Dolphins to win and didn't throw the game away. So
he almost threw it on a couple occasions. I mean, I will say like
look at every game, look at every NFL game, and there's a couple plays where you go, oh my god, how did they not make that
play? I mean, I think that one thing that we've said about Tua is that he has that penchant to like throw, like to make one of those boneheaded decisions. But I mean, there were like four cases where it should have been a point blank interception. And it's like, I don't know what type of gloves the Steelers defenders were using. I mean, toward the end of the first half, he threw up like a punt that should have been intercepted. Even on the last drive that they had, I mean, he threw a low pass that if, you know, the Steelers defender gets under it a little bit more, I mean, that's a game changing interception. I think I'm willing to kind of give Tua the, you know, the rust factor, because he said, hey, I mean, it is a little different when you're out there, when you're not out there for 3 weeks, you come back and you're getting the live reps. But I think that one thing that stuck in my mind after that game, and as it pertains to the offense, was, okay, this is the fourth full game that we've had with Tua. I won't count Cincinnati. Obviously, he got knocked out of that game. This is the fourth full game that we've had with Tua and running this offense. And I'll say this. Outside of the fourth quarter of the Baltimore game in week two, how has this offense looked to you?
It's
It's more or less than an above average to above average offense.
Right. It's not overall. It is not. It's not an offense that you can depend on. It's explosive. Clearly,
they can move the ball.
They can move the ball. They got great big play potential, but it's not something you can depend on. It's not an offense you can depend on, and it's not an offense that clearly, punches it in often.
That's the interesting thing, because I was looking at a mid game, and the stats said that they were the fourth best red zone offense team. Obviously that went down to fifth after this game. So it's like when they get, I think it was 12 out of 17 opportunities entering Sunday, when they got into the red zone, they scored a touchdown. The yards per game is right around league average, above league average, but it's like, something is like missing there. Obviously, the numbers might be a little bit skewed because Tua wasn't around for a couple games, but it's like they can move the ball, but they're not really finishing the drives, you know?
No, they're not. I mean, look, the games you've referenced, the Patriots game,
they had the one Waddle play, and that was more or less it.
Right. And let's see,
the Bills game, they weren't on the field.
Bills game, they had a short field on the strip sack, right? The other night they drove the ball down the field, got it in the end zone, and then
in the second half it was punt. It was turnover on downs, punt.
But after the first drive, you go field goal, and then that they weren't able to sustain the momentum, and the Steelers also made adjustments, and clearly it was I think sometimes when you're playing a team like the Dolphins, when you have guys like Hill and Waddle, it's hard to simulate that in practice and simulate that speed and simulate what they can do, and teams can take a second to adjust to it. And in fact, there were a couple of those, even on that first drive, there were a couple of plays, or maybe the first two drives, there were a few plays where you thought,
I thought it was taking
a if Tua had thrown the ball just a little bit, had better placement on the pass.
Yeah.
Yeah. It got completed, but it would allow those guys to keep on running. And I think that was, that's possibly a difference of, a few weeks off. But again, it's almost tiring parsing this though every week.
I think that the expectation was, and obviously, I mean, I said it myself. I said that, and maybe I'm kind of being a little bit hypocritical to criticize the offense so much in the first half of the season, because before the season started, I said, hey, it's going to take some time to get it to gel. But I'm thinking, like, with the guys that they have, I mean, at wide receiver, at running back, at tight end, the offensive line has been, with Armstead back in the lineup, they and Shell on the right side, the offensive line didn't allow a sack, they looked good. I'm thinking, like, I mean, again, I'll give them time to work it out, but like 16 points a game, 17 points, like 20 points a game. I mean, they're right around where they were last year when they were scoring like 20 points a game. I mean, I don't think anybody expected them to be the greatest show on turf in year one, but like, I mean, the output is similar to last year. I mean, nobody foresaw that and expected that even in the first half of the season. So again, there's time to get it right, but I'm just saying, I mean, now we have a 4-game sample size of this offense, and we're seeing similar things where, yeah, they have the explosive guys, they can move the ball downfield, but you look up and there's the points aren't there to show for it.
Right. Yeah. And you'd think that's eventually going to bite them. Probably not, against the Detroit Packers, but that'll probably come back to bite them. Maybe against in a rematch against the Jets, rematch against Buffalo.
Yeah, some of the better teams, and I will add a caveat. They've played some pretty good defenses through the first, kind of six games, seven games of the year. obviously facing the Bills and playing the Jets, who have a pretty good defense, and the Patriots, who, you know, before Monday night looked like they were starting to round things together. So I will give them that.
Yeah.
The schedule does start to ease up a little bit, like we said, starting with this game against the Lions, who don't have a good defense. They give up a lot of points. So we'll see, you know, maybe they can string some games together, and maybe you start to see that improvement. But, you know, we're seeing a similar trend. So it'll be interesting to see what adjustments Mike McDaniel and that crew makes, along with Tua playing his second straight game. We're going to take a short break, but when we come back on the side of things, the trade deadline is coming up next week, Tuesday. Should the Dolphins make a move? And if so, for what position? We're going to talk about that and more. So stay locked with us. What's going on, everybody? Still here on the Dolphins In Depth podcast with David Neal, talking all things Dolphins. And David, as I alluded to on this other half of the podcast, the NFL trade deadline is coming in just 1 week. Next Tuesday is the deadline for teams to make moves. We've already seen some big moves across the NFL, with the San Francisco 49ers trading for Christian McCaffrey. I think just yesterday, the Jets traded for James Robinson after Breece Hall went down for the year. I know a lot of Dolphins fans are kind of, you know, a little nervous about the injuries that have dwindled the depth at various positions over the first half of the season. And they're pleading, begging Chris Greer to make a move. I think, you know, we've seen over the course of, you know, the first seven games, cornerback. I mean, the Dolphins had three healthy cornerbacks on Sunday, and they're able to get away with that. I was surprised that they, you know, went into the game with just three healthy cornerbacks, but obviously Justin Bethel, Noah Igbinoghene, they stepped up with some big plays. It looks like they're going to get Kader Kohou and Keon Crossan back, but Byron Jones, it doesn't seem like he's ready to return from that offseason leg surgery. You know, on the offensive line, we've seen Austin Jackson miss the last six games, I believe, and he might not return to practice this week as well. And even at various positions, you know, safety, they just had Brandon Jones, their starting strong safety, go down, so they're going to have to replace him. If there's one position the Dolphins should target ahead of the trade deadline, which position is it?
I'm not a big fan. I mean, the NFL trade deadline,
or you could say they should, or you could say they should stand pat, because
I mean, obviously you would want, I think you'd want them to trade for if they can get a quality corner, get a starting corner for, I don't know, a two or a three.
A two. Oh, you'd give premium draft capital. I mean, the Dolphins have it. They don't have one of their 2-1s because obviously they got it taken away in the Ross right. scandal, tampering scandal. But they do have an extra third, I believe, from the Devontae Parker trade. They've amassed some picks. You'd be willing to give a day two, an early day two.
Yeah. Well, you know, for a solid starting corner, not a maybe starting corner, because I don't, you know, let's, you know, you're going to get X back, and to pair with X, you need another solid starting corner. And, you know, despite how well the corners played this week, you know, against Pickett's charge, let's, you know, that's still playing with your chips not on the pass line on one of the little smaller things over there, just waiting for them to take your money off the table. So I think you need, that's where you need your, that's what I'd trade for if I were the Dolphins, if they're going to do anything. It's the NFL trade deadline is, it always feels like, unless there's a really dissatisfied person or dissatisfied player, or a team that's just saying, okay, to heck with it, that it seems like you don't get value. It doesn't feel like you get value.
So there's very few cases in recent memory where, like, you can say, like, a Super Bowl contender made a move for a guy that really moved the needle and pushed them over the hump, you know. So I agree with you there. And I do agree with you that if there's one position that I would target that I would make a move if I were in the front office for the Dolphins, it'd be cornerback. Just because of the nature of it being a premium position and it being a premium position for the Dolphins defense. I think that again, it was great that Noah and Justin Bethel were able to, kind of step up with those interceptions. And then when they get Kader Kohou back, who started some games, when they get Keon Crossen, who's added some depth, I think that they'll be fine. Like I told a fan that was asking a question about whether they thinks that the Dolphins will make a move at defensive back. I said, like, if all those guys are back, Byron, because I'm not even sure. We talked about this. I'm not even sure if Byron's going to come back right now. The way it's trending with him. That's just my personal opinion. If you have all those guys back minus Byron, you're fine in the very sense of the word. The defensive line has been stepping up. Josh Boyer has been kind of adjusting to his personnel as defensive coordinator. But if there is a cornerback out there that you can get, and I know that a lot of fans have been talking about William Jackson, who plays for the Washington Commanders. He's been kind of disgruntled. He has experience in a man-to-man type defense. If you can get a guy like that, you make that move. But if not, if it's just going to be like a reserve offensive tackle, a backup line, like those moves, like. I mean, you can find guys to contribute. And I think the Dolphins have showed that by their lack of moves so far, that they feel confident with the guys that are in the building. I mean, again, they went into Sunday with three healthy cornerbacks. And again, they got kind of, I don't want to say they got lucky, but they kind of did just in the sense that, they didn't sustain any injuries because if they had one injury to the cornerback position on Sunday, they're in a dire situation. I mean, all three of those guys have to play virtually every snap.
And they were also that lucky. They were playing a talented rookie, but a rookie nonetheless. Without Pittsburgh's receivers, I'm not.
It's not a real offense. I mean,
Yeah,
that's not a legitimate
no.
offense.
And yeah, I was sitting there thinking. I mean, as it was a great interception to close the game. Great job getting his feet in and everything. But I was wondering
It was a bad pass. Yeah, I don't know if
oh,
he.
what the heck are you doing throwing
Yeah, I mean, he could have
the
scrambled.
ball?
I thought he would. I was watching it again. I was like, I thought he could have just scrambled, and he just throws a pass inside, and the receiver's
Yeah.
going inside to the end zone.
The receiver didn't even make a move for him. The receiver's like, what are you doing? You can't even see me.
So it was definitely a matchup where they were able to get away with that, but it's not
Right.
something. I mean, I don't think. I would think that the Dolphins know that the norm isn't that they're going to go into a game with three healthy cornerbacks.
Right.
So again, I mean, outside of cornerback and even offensive tackle, I mean, I don't think it's the pressing need that it appeared to be. Obviously, I mean, when Teron Armstead and Austin Jackson were out of the lineup, yeah, I mean, the offensive line kind of fell apart. And you still do have reservations about Armstead battling that toe injury because it seems like it's going to be something that sticks with him for the rest of the season. But if he's able to stay in the lineup, when he's been in the lineup, he's played well. Brandon Shaw, I mean, he's looked pretty good. I mean, the best thing you can say about an offensive lineman is that you don't notice them and you don't say their name. And I didn't notice Brandon Shaw on at right tackle on Sunday. So I think that means that he did a pretty solid job. When Austin Jackson comes back, I'm assuming he'll go back to that starting role. Brandon Shaw seems like he can be a viable, competent swing tackle that you need to step in if injury comes. I think you're set there. Obviously, you can never have too many good offensive linemen. We talked about this in training camp. You can never have too many good linemen. You can never have too many good pass rushers. You can never have too many good cornerbacks. But again, like I don't. If I'm the Dolphins, I don't make a move just to be like, all right, I'm going to get a marginal
Yeah.
cornerback to add depth. I mean, they have depth. I mean, they got guys on the practice squad at the end of the roster who can step up and be marginal. But if you're talking about a game changer, and again, I don't know who the names are on that trade block or maybe possible to trade for. But if you can make a move that, like, okay, like you're elevating the defense. I mean, this defense now, I mean, they started to stack a couple games. But if you can get that guy that moves the needle, and I think a lot of it will kind of depend on what the team sees in Byron's potential availability for the rest of the year. Because if he's not able to return, and you don't think he's going to be on a trajectory or trending to where he's going to be able to return and play at the standard and the level that we've seen in the past, I think you definitely try to make that move. I mean, this is a team that has said for months and months and months, we think we're ready to win now. We think we're ready to compete. If you think you're ready to compete and there's a move to be made, especially at a position as important as cornerback on your team, I think you do it. And even if Byron doesn't come back, even if Byron does come back, then you again have three capable corners. I mean, Nick Needham went down for the year with an Achilles injury, which really messed up their depth because he plays inside, he plays outside. Right. He probably would have played some safety after Brandon Jones went down, but he obviously wasn't available. So cornerback is the one position where I say, yeah, if you can find a guy that fits your system and moves the needle for your defense, you give up premium draft capital. I'm not doing a one unless it's like, I mean, I don't know, some top flight cornerback on the market. But yeah, I dip into the day two stash for sure.
Yeah. I mean, also, I mean, they win the game with three healthy cornerbacks. I mean, you're facing a lot of the good offenses, the real offenses, you know, you need that just to get in the door.
Yeah.
And just get on the field. And, you know, if you don't come with that, you need three starting quality cornerbacks, you know, just to survive once things get cold, and around people start returning gifts. So, I don't think they need, they can probably survive with the three, you know, another three cornerbacks this week against the, you know, Detroit Hudson's, you know, because it's Detroit. I mean.
Nah, for sure. I mean, three cornerbacks is that's dicey. That's dicey business. But, you know, like you said, they are facing a Detroit Lions team that is 1-5. It's faced some struggles. I mean, I think that there were a lot of people, you know, they're coached by a former Dolphins assistant and, you know, that stepped into the interim role, Dan Campbell. He's leading that group in Detroit. I think that a lot of people saw, you know, year two of him is, you know, this is the year that maybe they can take a little bit of a step. Haven't seen it as much. 1-5 record. Yeah. One of the worst
step defenses. On a banana peel.
Yeah, one of the worst defenses in the NFL. They're allowing the most yards per play in the league as well as the second most points so far. And I got to say, if there's any game, I mean, I thought last week was with Tua coming back, I thought that was going to be the week that we saw them really explode and this offense take off. You got to take off against this. I mean, you got to take off against this defense.
They don't stop nobody. I mean, that's it. It's like, you know,
Yeah, I mean, 32.3 points per game told they're allowing. I mean, that's
healthier than downtown points. Detroit.
Yeah. I mean, I was gonna say they've allowed the second most points in the NFL, but they're averaging the most points allowed because they played one fewer game in the New Orleans Saints. Four more points per game than the Saints.
That's just bad.
Yeah, I mean, there's not. I mean, they do have some. They do have some firepower on offense. Obviously, Jared Goff can throw the ball around. They have St. Brown, the wide receiver, who's coming back from concussion protocol. They have a good offensive line. But again, I mean, I think that before the season, we saw this slate right here. I mean, it started kind of starting with the Steelers game, where you have the Steelers, you have the Lions, the Bears, and then, you know, we have games against the Texans and the Browns. I think we all viewed this part of the schedule as, all right, this is where you can start to stack some games. I mean, ahead of that kind of treacherous December slate, you know, they're 4-3 right now. I think that that's generally right around where most people expected them to be. Again, I don't think that people expected them to get to it this way, but you're 4-3, third in the division. It doesn't seem like the Jets are going to fall off anytime soon. I mean, I don't know if they're for real, but, you know, they're 5-2 right now. So I expect them to keep on winning some games. Obviously, the Bills are in a class of their own. And you do have to start stacking some wins, you know, to really set yourself up for that stretch run. And I think they do. I mean, again, I guess, you know, last week I said I thought that was a ready-made matchup for the Dolphins to really take advantage of the Steelers' defense. I was wrong. But I'm going back. I'm doubling down. I think this is the week where they start to take off. Another week of Tua, get that chemistry, get that rapport down with some of those receivers. I think we see their you know, their best offensive game since week two against the Ravens. I think they win. I won't say in a rout because, you know, it's tough to blow out NFL teams as I witnessed last weekend. I won't say a rout, but I think that the offense really takes off in Detroit. What do you think?
I'm gonna say I'm ordering up a 40 burger.
40 burger. Okay.
And there's not a lot other than their uniforms and Ford Field. There's not a lot to like about the Detroit Edsels. So that defense is just tailor made. This is the week. This is your buffet week. You know, this is your buffet week, Tyreek.
Piccadilly week. This is Piccadilly.
Yeah, let's get up early Sunday brunch and let's eat. Let's get load up on the bacon and the eggs, English muffins. You know,
I will say the Lions do, again, they do have some offensive weapons. They are sixth in yards per play. They're top 10 in points, which is higher than the Dolphins. So this could be a shootout. I mean, this could be the type of game where the offense does really need to put up closer to 30 points to win.
I think the Dolphins D will. I think they'll handle enough business enough against Jared Goff. I won't say 40-21.
I mean, that's a blowout. I mean, that's a blowout.
Yeah. I think this is a game that sets up that way, and there's no reason it shouldn't be. Now, of course, again, of course, the NFL. You know, we thought there was no reason for what happened last night in New England, but I just don't see the Lions being the team that jumps up and surprises the Dolphins like that. I just think it's a bad matchup for Detroit, and Dolphins going to do to them what White Flight did in the riots did to it, the city.
I could always count on you for a good one-liner. If anything, I count on you for a good one-liner. So yeah, I mean, we're both taking the Dolphins. Again, I think that, as I said before, this is the part of the schedule where if you're a real contender, you got to start stacking up some wins there. We both think that they will. But as I always say, I mean, that's why we play the games on Sunday. So we'll see how they fare. That brings us to the end of another edition of the Dolphins In Depth podcast. I want to thank you all so much for tuning in. Reminder to share, like, subscribe, comment below.
Subscribe.
All that good stuff. We'll be back next week to recap another weekend of Dolphins football. But until then, you guys take care. See you.